in qualche modo, eh? Che dici? Sorry, I forgot. There are two. Two keywords in this workshop, in this school. One is atomistic and the other is continuum. And continuum was, Del Piero is playing for continuum and I'm playing for atomistic. But we are not playing one against the other, but rather try to reach some connection. In particular, from my point of view, the real problem is this one, is that there are two facts. One fact is that body, solids, or fluids are made of atoms and molecules. And let's say, typically, there are kind of 10 to the 23 atoms or molecules in a body. And so there are three times these degrees of freedom. While the same body, when it's described in the continuum version, let's say in thermodynamics, and equilibrium states in thermodynamics is determined by a few parameters. For instance, density and temperature are enough, plus the equation of state, you know everything about the system. So how is that possible that from one side there are 10 to the 23 degrees of freedom and from the other side there are three? Or six, or whatever. So it's very important to find this connection. And from an atomistic point of view, it's important to get into continuum. But also, from the other side, it's kind of obvious. I mean, this was very well explained in the previous lecture by Del Piero, because he started with a continuum description, and then at some point he put discontinuities. No, so it sounds strange that you study continuum with discontinuities. No, it's clearly at the discontinuity the continuum description is failing, and you would like to enlarge it in order to see what's happening really. So you are going from continuum toward atomistic. I'm going from atomistic to continuum, but we will not meet each other, but almost. Okay, so. This is the first lecture. Let me, in the next slide, I have the contents of the full thing. So there is a first lecture, it's today, about phase transitions at zero temperature. And then there will be, the other lectures will be related to the fact that going to positive temperature creates a lot of problems. So there will be different steps toward understanding this, and I will not try now to say what are these steps, because either you are an expert in the subject, then you understand what it's written, otherwise it would take too long, it would not be. So let me just start with lecture one. And you remember in the title there is emergence of microstructure. So this is an obscure notion, so I will try to explain it in the beginning. So I start by explaining the meaning of emergence of microstructure in the title. So the way I want to see it, because I'm looking from a statistical mechanic point of view, will be a competition. There will be forces which are on long range, and forces which are on short range, and they will be interfering with each other. And from this competition, there will emerge microstructures. So in order to explain this, I decided to follow Stefan Müller, who gave several years ago some lectures on elasticity. And he has an example which I think explains very well this fact that there are two different spatial scales. By the way, feel free to ask questions whenever. I mean, they will be helpful to me rather than... Okay, So, Stefan Müller example is this one. So it's you see, I'm not far from what Giampiero was doing. So I have my functional. It's also in one dimension. I call it F of U. F because it's not really an energy, but it's a free energy. But at the moment, it's just a mathematical object. So it's also F for functional. So F of U is this integral that you see there. So I should say where it's defined. Well, it's defined where it should be. So in this way, I'm not wrong. Okay, so I want to minimize this functional. And you see that this functional describes a competition. And the competition is between the first and the second term. You see, the first term contains the derivative of u. And the derivative of u likes to be either plus one or minus one. Okay, so I want linear functions there. And the second term is u square, and u square wants u to be zero. No, so there is clearly a competition. And where are the scales? Well, the integral of u square, we may say it's on the scale one, because I'm integrating from zero to one. It's something like that. Du dx, the derivative of u, is instead defined on, it depends on the infinitesimal variation of u. So we may say that the u over dx is something which fills an infinitesimal scale. So I have the competition between something on scale one and something on scale zero. So the two scales are infinitely far apart. So why this creates a microstructure? The reason is that f of u has no minimum, but its inf is zero. So if the inf is zero, clearly cannot be a minimum, because it would require u to be zero, because there is an integral of u square. And if u is zero, its derivative is zero, and du over dx is zero, and so there is the first term is one. No, so there can't be a function which has a zero free energy, but zero can be achieved by a minimizing sequence. And that's obvious, because I can do something like that. So I do oscillations with slope plus and minus one. So the derivative is nice, it's glad. It's everything working, but they are very frequent, so that u doesn't grow. It's in this picture stays between plus epsilon and minus epsilon. So I'm getting a minimizing sequence which depends on epsilon with period 4 epsilon. So there is very fast oscillations on very small scale. I mean, there is not in this example a preferential scale. No, these oscillations are, this emergence of microstructure has no scale because they go to zero. If I wanted to make a period, I would need to complicate the model by penalizing second derivatives. Then there can't be too many. But this is beyond the purposes of this lecture. So this is just to say that competition between different scales may lead to microstructures. This is one of the aspects that I want to consider in this, my lectures. So the other one in the title was phase transitions. So phase transitions, it's a very deep fact. From at least even a philosophical point of view, because it's saying that states of matter like liquid, gas, or solid are in fact accidental. They are not substantial. Because a same body with same atoms, with same molecules, may appear either as a gas or as a liquid or as a solid, according to the external conditions. So it's really accidental whether the state is liquid, solid, or gas. So this is the phase transition I want to consider, but I want to study it in a more specific setup. So I will further restrict the notion, and technically I will talk about first order phase transitions with order parameter the mass density. So this, I imagine, looks obscure to most of you, so and to me as well, so I will try to explain it. And the explanation is simple, because it means the following, that if I have a phase transition with first order with order parameter the mass density, it means that there is a forbidden interval of densities. So there is an interval rho prime, rho double prime of densities which are forbidden. So what does it mean that they are forbidden? I mean, clearly I have my box in which I put the fluid, and I may put in this box, let's call it lambda, a mass which is rho times the volume of lambda, with rho chosen in the forbidden interval. So I certainly can do that. So I put in this box this fluid with this total density. Then if there is a phase transition, it means that in some parts, let's say lambda prime of the box, I will see a density rho prime. And in the complement, I will see the density rho double prime. So I can certainly try to put that amount of mass, but I don't see it in the box, because I either see rho prime or rho double prime. I don't see that one. No? So, okay, so this is the phenomenon that I want to study, to concentrate. And let us see the connection with Stefan Müller. So here, rho prime and rho double prime, which are the two densities, will play the role that in Stefan Müller example had the two slopes, minus one and plus one. So once I say that if I try to put a given amount of mass in a box, then it splits, that is, the density is in some part is rho prime, in some other part is rho double prime, automatically leads to the problem on how these two parts of fluids are separated. And this is a problem which is known in the literature as the Wolf problem. Wolf-shaped problem is the search for the optimal geometry with which the two phases separate. And this this will be the object of the last lecture, because the phenomenon is ruled by the surface tension, and surface tension is something which is more difficult than the things that I will start studying. And then the emergence of microstructure comes because we shall study, as I was saying, systems where there are forces which act on very different scales. So the long-range scale force will try to impose some density, rho, on some scale. And this density, rho, will be a forbidden density for the short range part of the interaction. So there is kind of a frustration, because there is the long range which tries to put some density, some local density rho, and then the short range force which doesn't like rho. And so they split. And then what happens will be will be that there will be formation of very many small wolf shapes around, and we will try to understand how they are formed and what's their geometry. So this is more or less what I want to do. So I will start explaining phase transitions. I will start explaining why there is a forbidden interval of densities, and then we'll move toward more and more complicated or finer structures. So the first part today will be to try to explain why there is a forbidden interval of densities from an atomistic point of view. And this can be understood pretty well and without knowing much about statistical mechanics if we look at zero temperature. So I will restrict this lecture to zero temperatures. And the system I want to describe is a system of point particles which represent molecules. And the molecules in general are studied by saying that they interact with pair interactions. And the pair interaction is a Lennard-Jones potential. So it's something as in the picture. And there is a divergence at the origin and a tail at infinity, which is integrable. So this is the interaction between two points, which are at relative position r. So the energy of a configuration Q made of points Q1, Qn is the sum of the interactions between the points. I'm neglecting the kinetic part of the energy because I'm at zero temperature where we know that we are looking for the minimum of the energy. So to minimize the energy, it's better to put all velocities zero. So I will forget about the velocities, only the positions, and then I'm doing this. Should also say that this is quite unrealistic because I'm doing zero temperature in a classical setup. I should use quantum mechanics, but this is an example for what I want to say afterwards. And in any case, I wouldn't feel very comfortable with quantum mechanics at this stage. So it's better I stick to the simple system, which is simple but not so much. So the energy, the one half is because I don't want to count twice each interaction, each pair. So this is the energy. And then the basic postulate is that the energy density at zero temperature, when the mass density is rho, is the minimum of the energy among configurations with density rho. So in order to define this, I should first fix a box, lambda, put n particles in that box, so Q1, Qn, then I take the inf of the energy, that's h of q, I take the inf of h of q, and then I divide by lambda. And this is the energy density in lambda when the number of particles is n. Since I want a density rho, I should have n over lambda to converge to rho. And what's interesting in all these things is to study the limit of infinite volume, because I'm thinking of macroscopic systems. So there, it will contain a lot of particles in a very large box in terms of interparticle distances. No, so this justifies taking lambda to Rd, and then I have to take n to infinity, but with the right ratio. And what I should take the lim of is the inf of the energy. The lim inf, the first lim inf that you read is not necessary. It's actually a lim. But in order to avoid the issue of convergence, I just wrote lim inf. So this is the ground state energy when the density is rho. And the ground state in a box lambda is the minimizer of the inf of H of Q. And then I may try to define ground states in the old space by taking weak limits of the ground states in finite region, but I won't talk very much about that. Okay, so I mean, given this postulate, now it's only a question of theorems, no? Because we have the potential, so we have the energy, we have defined what are the ground states, and now we have to find them. That's just like that. I mean, it's simple to say. In all statistical mechanics, it's very simple to make statements, but it's very difficult to prove them. So this one, actually, the solution to this problem is pretty recent, as we shall see. It's something like less than 10 years ago. So the main result, it's only in two dimensions. So here, it's two dimension is important. It's not because I want to draw pictures. It's because one dimension, it's a little non-interesting. So two dimension is the first interesting case, and it's the simplest. So the main result, and now I'm trying to say that in words, says that there is a critical density Rossi. This means that if I take a density which is larger than Rossi, I really see a ground state. And this ground state is a configuration of particles which are on a triangular lattice. If I try to put a density rho, which is less than Rossi, then I don't find the ground state. So if I take ground states with density rho in a finite volume, and then I take the limit that I see is either Rossi or zero. Strange, you see? So why is that? It's because the ground state in the region lambda are made in this way. I mean, if you try to grow, I mean, you are growing a crystal, no? So this crystal grows, if you put a mass which is rho, uses mass rho c up to some point where it finds mass, and then it stops. So if I put a density rho in a box lambda, I see a piece of crystal with density rho c, and then the empty, the void state. So there will be, for instance, half of the box which has the crystal with density rho c and the other half which is empty. So if I take the limit, if I'm in the region where there is the crystal, I see rho c. If I'm in the other region, I see zero. So the lattice is a triangular lattice, and if I want a density rho, I should take a mesh which is such that gives rise to that mesh. The particles are in the continuum, so they are free to stay wherever. But if they want to minimize the energy, they like to be at very specific distance one from the other, which is the one in. Sorry? This is the, with the Lennard Jones potential. Also, because I keep saying van der Waals instead, it's Jones. This is pretty general. There must be a repulsive part at the origin and a negative tail. The fact that the tail is infinite makes the proof more difficult.
So the key point is that in the interaction potential, there is a length scale increasing because of this combination.
Yeah.
But in the Lennard Jones, it's not.
Yeah. Yeah, and you see, there is. I mean, you may try to say that the best is to put particles exactly at the minimum between them, but it's not totally clear because there is not only interactions. I mean, the interaction is long range, so it's maybe more convenient to shift a little bit to the left. Then the nearest neighbor has a slightly larger interaction, but then there are many more afterwards. So it depends really on the shape of the thing. I mean, it's not obvious how to solve the problem. No, it's, I mean, if you give me n particle in a box lambda, and this n is not too large, then what I do is I put them very close to each other. And then stop. This is better than try to put them, but I mean, this, you are destroying my lecture because I wanted to do a little bit of this, so because I want to explain why there is this forbidden interval. We are already seeing that there will be a forbidden interval because of what I've said, but let's see technically how this comes out. So this, I guess, I've already said. So the ansatz, I mean, since we are studying at zero temperature, we are talking about crystals. And we know that crystals are made by a cell which is repeated periodically in the space. I mean, that's the typical structure of a crystal. So since we have a very simple system with all identical particles, we may think also that cells are made by single particles. Okay, so let's say we want to put these particles, so they form a lattice. So if they form a lattice, which lattice could they form? And what I was saying is that a triangular lattice in two dimensions is the best. Why is that? Because it has the largest number of neighbors. So this is exercise that you have to do. I mean, if you, I don't know whether, I didn't write it. I wrote it in my notes, but I didn't put it here. So if you put particles in Z2, each site has four neighbors. If you put particles on a triangular lattice, then each site has six neighbors. So it's better triangular than square. Now the question is, can you make something better than six? So can you have a lattice in two dimensions with nearest neighbors which are more than six? The answer is not. So this is exercise. So as mentioned before, the answer is correct for rho larger than rho c, but it won't for rho less than rho c. But let's presume it's correct everywhere, and let's see whether we reach a contradiction or not. So the energy of a triangular lattice, I claim, is something of as this shape. The important point of the shape, so this is the answer to previous question of Mario, that I mean, if I want in a triangular lattice a density rho, I should take a mesh which goes like rho to the minus one half. I mean, if you do the computation, maybe it's written in some slides afterwards. So I want to convince you that the shape is this one, and the important point is that initially it's concave and then becomes convex. I mean, you are understanding from if you remember the previous lecture, it was very much underlined that the energy was convex and everything was going well with convexity. Then it became no longer convex with the fractures. Here also we are in a non-convex regime, and that's the reason for all the troubles. This is the E of rho. So the energy of a triangular lattice with density rho, and goes like that. So let's see what did I do? Yeah. So so here is a computation of why the mesh is related to the density in the way I've written. So it's we do the exercise then. Okay. So I claim that rho has that form. So let's see. So I have to compute the density on a triangular lattice. So I would say that the area of a triangle with three equal sides of length r goes like as c, it's equal to c prime r square. C prime because I didn't want to do the computation of the actual area of the triangle. So this is in the denominator. So the three in the numerator is because in each triangle there are three particles. And then there is a six in the denominator is because each point, I count it six times when I follow your configuration. Okay. So this was the exercise. So the energy density of the configuration of a triangular configuration. So let's start computing the energy of a configuration H of Q. So it's defined in the way it's written. So it's the energy of a particle QI interacting with all the others. So, and that's what it's written there. So, in order to compute the energy of the configuration of a triangular configuration, I have to compute the energy of a point in a triangular lattice interacting with all the others. Okay, so the interaction, so here, I mean, I'm not doing the exact computation. I just want to prove that there is a concave and convex part. And this comes out by a scaling argument. No? Because if R is the mesh of the triangular interaction, of the triangular lattice, then I mean, you remember in the van der Waals, in the Leonard Jones, the repulsive part was the distance to the minus 12. Now the distance I made it's r to the minus 12, which is the mesh, times the distance on the lattice with mesh one, analogously for this one, for the attractive part. Then finally I get this expression for the energy when the mesh is rho. It's this one. So there is a convex and a concave part. So this was to convince you that this is the shape. Okay, so if you didn't follow the computation, you didn't miss much. I mean, it's kind of obvious, I would say, that it comes out something of this form. It's non-convex and it has that shape. Okay. So so it is not convex. So if it is not convex, I can convexify it. And that's what it's written there. So there will be E star T with a star. I denote the convexification of the previous function. And so this will be a linear segment in an interval up to rho C. Rho C is the point where the segment ends. So the convexification in this critical interval, it's a linear thing, which has this shape. Okay, so this is so now we come to the point that to the claim that there is a forbidden interval. So that's the important point. So I rewrote the expression for the convexified, and it's obvious from the picture and from the formula that if rho is smaller than rho c, then Easter T of rho is smaller than E T of rho. Okay, so this would mean that you may say at this point that it's no longer convenient to have a triangular configuration with density rho because there is an energy which is smaller, which is this one. But I have to convince you that this is the energy of a configuration. No, because I can certainly define functions which are smaller than this. No. So, I mean, this is also obvious from what I said, because, I mean, I may write again this function in this form, because I have added zero. Okay. So this means that I may read this in this form, that I have an energy ET of rho c in a fraction of the volume, which is rho over rho c, and I have energy zero in the complement. This suggests that I can approximate my energy by putting, as I was saying before, in some part of the volume a triangular configuration with mesh related to rho c, and in the other the empty. So if I do that, I indeed find in the limit Easter T of rho, because what I'm missing in this computation are surface energies, and the energy is defined by dividing by the volume. So modulo surface effects, I get Easter T of rho. Okay, so I mean, another thing is let's compute what is rho c. So in order to compute rho c, I write again this function, which I should have written instead of E of rho, Easter T of rho. This is a mistake. So Easter T of rho, the convexification, and E T of rho have same derivative at rho c. That's the definition of the convexification. So if they have the same derivative, it means that this inequality, this equality holds. Now, if you do some computation, you see that this holds if rho c is the minimizer of that expression. So in order, again, something, this is a proof of something that you may accept it without really following the argument, that in order to find the critical density, I have to minimize the energy ET of rho over rho. So ET of rho is the energy per unit volume. Rho is the density per unit volume. This ratio is the energy per particle. So in order to find the critical value of the density, I have to minimize the energy per particle. So why I'm missing something? So it's, I think here there is something like 45 pages missing. So the reason is that what's happening? I Okay, so I think I'll have to put my computer on. So let me just say two things that I can say without the thing. Is that, so this was heuristic so far. So what happens is that there is a theorem, and the theorem is by Florian Thiel. It appears in 2006, if you see. And it proves that the energy per particle is minimized exactly at the rho c that I was talking before. So the minimum of the energy per particle is achieved at the density rho c, and is achieved by a configuration which is triangular. There is a more recent paper by Guido Frieseke who proves, you see it's in the archive, 2009, he studies the wolf shape for this problem. So he puts, he studies the problem where in a box lambda, well, no, not really that, without box, he puts n particles in the system, in the space, and want to find the minimal energy, and they find that they form a crystal with bulk density rho c, and he studies the shape of the, I mean, what happens at the boundaries. The paper of Frieseke refers to an interaction which has finite range. So I guess if you want, we take a break of 5 minutes or 10 minutes, because I have to put my computer, because here I hope I have the full file in the other. So, huh? No, I have the other one. It's for the afternoon. Okay, so let's stop a second. Not totally obvious. It requires a proof. Then there is another question, is that it's not only bounded from below, the energy per particle, but if you try to put many particles together, then the energy grows more than quadratically. And that's because the energy at the origin in the Lennard-Jones potential diverges. So this is what it's called technically in statistical mechanics, superstability estimates. Superstability because it's something more than stability. And so I've written something there where, with these proofs. And then there is another question which is interesting, and it's may give rise to some exercises at least, and or even some research problem, is this fact that I mean, one wants to understand how much cost in energy to create fluctuations of density where the density becomes large. So you want to compare this with situation where there is not this, these fluctuations. Now this is pretty easy to prove if you, that you pay a lot of energy if you put many particles in a small domain, but it's quite more difficult to estimate this excess of energy if you constrain the system to have a given number of particles. No? Because if, I mean, it's easy to say that if you put many particles somewhere close to each other, there is a lot of energy there. No, but so you want to say, okay, so let's not put them together and let's put them far apart. But then you have to put them somewhere. And where you put them costs energy. And so you have a balance, which is not obvious, on how to redistribute these particles in the space in order to see that actually it costs to put them together. And this is related to what it's called in analysis, rearrangement inequalities. And it's also related to transport, mass transport, and Bassistine distance. All these notions play together. So in these complements, I've written something of this sort that we may try to discuss together, maybe more on the blackboard than on transparencies. So this will be, I mean, I have the transparencies and we can do the two things together. Okay, so I would say I will stop here now and let's have some swimming. Thank you. Francesco, due e mezzo o tre e mezzo?
Okay, so we said to replace the Griffith energy with the regularized energy of this type. And that means to replace this, I call this energy now theta, which is a function of the jump opening U. And so here I add the sum of the energies of all jumps. And this theta is called cohesive energy. Ma il meglio dovrebbe essere perpendicolare, no? Fai presto. Proviamo? Proviamo? No, no, no. Quella sopra, casomai, così va meglio. No? Ancora allora, ancora due. So this I call theta cohesive energy, and this is a very fundamental concept, because this goes back to Coulomb, essentially. Coulomb is known in continuum mechanics for two main achievements. One is Coulomb's friction, and the other is exactly his application of Coulomb's friction to the rupture of materials. That means to suppose that inside the body there are slip planes in which the Coulomb law of friction applies. But in this case, it is not friction, it's just cohesion, internal cohesion of the material. And if you wish, this approach, which is not of mine, of course, which is, goes to Barenblatt, to Dugdale, and so on, is an application of his old ideas to energy minimization. So there is some cohesive energy after a crack has been opened, which connects the two parts of the crack. And in books on Romessel Mouse, queste cose sono di una complicazione unica. Non vedo il mouse. Eccolo qua. In books on rupture of concrete, in which the application of Barenblatt goes to the 70s, so it was very early compared with the present literature, you see pictures like this. There is a piece of concrete, a crack which is opening, and you see that there is some residual force which is transmitted across the crack, because there are small stones or things like that. This is for concrete. For other materials, you may have some different explanation. And the diagram below is just the force transmitted across the crack, which, as you see, is a function, is a decreasing function of the crack opening. In fact, the force across a crack is just the derivative of theta, theta prime, and if I succeed in getting the preceding slide, no, nothing to do. Let me go up. You just see that okay, you should see, because I don't see the way of going back. Okay, let's go back. Maybe this way, no? There is no way of going back, I'm sorry. Hey, sì, ma non ci va. Vai, ecco, la sette dovrei vedere. Sì. 9, 10, 11. 9, 8, ancora una, ecco, grazie. So this is a diagram of theta prime. In the Dale model, which is D, the force stays constant for a while and then drops to zero. And in Barenblatt, the model just goes down more smoothly. So from the mathematical viewpoint, to have in mind the Barenblatt type model is more convenient. You don't have this jump, and it is also more physical. Okay? So this is the force, this theta prime is the force transmitted along a crack, across a crack. Okay, so the boundary conditions are always the same. They are not here anymore. Let me rewrite them. So we have that the integral of u prime plus the sum of the jumps is equal to beta L, and the integral of the perturbation plus the sum of the jump, I call them J, of the perturbation, eta, is equal to zero. Okay, same conditions as before. So if we wish to get conditions for a minimum, we just use the technique we already used with appropriate changes, due to the fact that now this energy term is smoother. So we go ahead with the same technique we used this morning. And we write that E of U plus epsilon eta is equal to W of U prime plus epsilon eta prime of X plus a sum of theta of U of X plus eta. And let me call the index here is difficult to say. Okay, let me call J, X J. With J, which goes to 1 to the number of jumps of U plus eta this time. So J are both the jumps of U plus the jumps of eta. Some of them may be 0, okay, depending on which perturbation I take. So if we take the difference of the two, here I put an epsilon, so let me write an epsilon here. I take first of this difference, and this difference is equal to, and here I put an epsilon, W prime of U prime of X, multiplied by eta prime of X. And then I have a sum in J, say, okay, theta prime of U of XJ eta of XJ plus higher order terms in epsilon. Okay, so we have a smoother second part, cohesive energy part. Okay, so what let's do exactly what we did with the Griffith, that is to say, let's start taking perturbations, smooth perturbations, without any discontinuity. So if I take a smooth perturbation, this term vanishes, okay? And we still have just this term here. And we again deduce, as before, that W prime of U prime is a constant, which I call sigma, exactly as before, and that U prime is also a constant. Okay. So, at this point, I can take this out. You see that it is always the same play. We can take this out, so this becomes W prime of U prime, or let's write just sigma for short. Sigma multiplied by integral of eta prime. Questo gesto non è buono come quello che avevo io ogni tanto. Ecco. So this sum, which is the same as before. And again, after that, we use this condition to replace the integral by minus the sum of the jumps. equal minus epsilon sigma multiplied by the sum of the jumps of eta. Here we don't have jumps of eta. I'm sorry. We deduced this. Then we go back to arbitrary perturbations as of today. So we have the jumps of eta. Plus this term. Oh, here I forgot a piece because I was taking the difference. So I must write here minus some e of theta of u of xi. Okay, I had forgotten this term here. Okay, and here I have exactly this term. So given this first result here, I recall that we define an equilibrium configuration as a configuration for which the first variation is greater or equal than zero, okay? So the first condition for equilibrium is this one, as before. Now we are reduced for equilibrium configurations to an energy of this type. Okay, so we will take two more types of perturbations. The one is the same perturbation we took with Griffith, that is to say, perturbation with a single jump at a jump point of u, okay? So we are assuming that u has a jump, and we take a perturbation at a single point of jumps. Perturbation at a single point. So in this case, we have that the first variation of the energy for this particular eta is equal to this term. So I don't write epsilon because when I write the second variation, I divide by epsilon, and so I have minus sigma multiplied this single perturbation, which I call eta, plus. So I have to write this difference now, okay? And this difference is, at the jump points for u, which are not a jump point for eta, these terms cancel. So it remains just the term for that specific point at which I have taken the eta. So I don't have any more a sum, but I have just a single term, which is theta prime of u evaluated at this specific jump point multiplied by eta. Okay? And this is the first variation. So I can collect eta, and I have something like this. Theta prime of u of x minus sigma, all multiplied by this jump amplitude eta, must be greater or equal than zero. Yes, theta prime is the cohesive energy, which is a function of the jump of u, of the jump amplitude. This is one. This is a stem, because this comes from here.
But that's only the jump.
You just sure you have this, but this is equal to that. So I made this substitution. Okay. So at this point, because I am on a jump point of u, this is arbitrary in sign. So this term has to be greater or equal than zero, equal to zero. So the second condition for equilibrium is that sigma be less or equal than theta prime of u. Okay. And this of yes. Sorry. All right. So and this holds for all jump points of U, of course, because on any of them, on any one of them, I can put this perturbation. And this result is trivial, again, because it says that at equilibrium, the force transmitted across the jump, which is theta prime, is equal to the force transmitted in the non-broken part of the bar. Okay? So this is, again, a trivial conclusion. Okay, now we have the last specific eta to take. That is, now I take a single perturbation on a point which is not a jump point for you. Okay. So in this case, I have something like that, with the only difference, I write it here below. This term is the same as before. Here I have zero. Sorry? A horizontal one. Okay. Okay, okay. So I will write, I need everything here. I don't know what to write. Okay, let me write here. So we have minus sigma multiplied by this jump eta plus. Here I had, so is okay this line? Is it okay? More or less. Okay. Plus, here this is zero now because it is the jump at the point in at which I made a perturbation. Multiplied by eta. So let me just collect this eta. This way. Okay, but this time eta is not arbitrary in sign. It must be greater or equal than zero. That means that the parenthesis must be greater or equal than zero as well. So here we have sigma has to be less or equal. This explains to you why I did a mistake before. I had in mind this one, which is this. So we have three consequences of equilibrium, one, two, and three. These are all necessary conditions of equilibrium. And it can be proved, I will not do the proof here, that they are also sufficient. And the proof, all of this material I am speaking about is collected in a paper. You will have the reference in the notes, Del Piero and Truskinowski. ...2009, Continuum Mechanics and Thermodynamics. All the subjects of the first four lectures, this is the second, is essentially contained there with more details. So if you wish to know why these conditions are also sufficient, please read the paper and you will find that. Just because I am speaking of that, the last two lectures will be the contained in a paper still in preparation, not yet published, but of which I gave already communications in different sections. So the first four and the last two, you have everything there. Okay, so for us equilibrium means three things. One is the usual thing that the force is constant. The second is that force at the jump points is equal to the force at the other points. And the third one is an upper bound for the force. So every equilibrium configuration must have a force which is not higher than this value. So you can imagine that if I start increasing beta, the force increases. When I arrive at this point, something should happen because I cannot go further. So this suggests that we can have a prediction of the initiation of fracture, something which was not true in the case of Griffith. And in fact, this is a picture of the energy now. As you see, the surface has been smoothened because on the jump axis, you see a smooth surface and not anymore the discontinuous surface of Griffith, and the vertical wall has disappeared, okay? Because I have a smooth function now. So, yes. Yeah, of course. Yeah, Bernblatt is smoother, so it is easy to make the picture. But all I said here holds for any theta for the moment. I will be more specific after, but for the moment, I am not making any assumption on theta, okay? But you are right, this is, the picture is for Bernblatt. So if I take a section with a loading line, as I did this morning for Griffith, I will get something like that, in which I don't have anymore the energy barrier. So the initial slope of this section, you see a surface made this way on the board. The initial slope is the one which decides whether or not I have the fracture. Because if the initial slope is positive, I still have an energy barrier. When it becomes zero, I have the possibility of reaching this minimum with a smooth path with non-increasing energy. So at this point here becomes accessible from that one. So this is roughly the idea. And so a first successful aspect of this regularization that we are making is that we can have a prediction of the formation of the fracture. And this is important, of course. Okay, so after that, yeah, sure.
I mean, this theory is not scaling variant, is it?
No.
In the sense that if you take a very large, very long theory,
you just are anticipating what I am going to say probably tomorrow, because this evening there is. But you are completely right. You are completely right. So, Professor Pesutti is. Let me just anticipate now, is pointing out what in fracture is called the size effect, the effect of the size. And this size effect was almost unknown in the ancient time. For instance, in the Renaissance, the builders, the architects knew perfectly that a big structure is more brittle than a small one. But for instance, the politicians, those who have the money, didn't know that. So they asked the architect to make us a model of the structure. And for them, the model of the structure made in wood instead of stone was the proof that the structure was able to stay. So they didn't have any idea of the Byzantine, when they make Hagia Sophia. And I shall speak of this on Friday night. They gave this job to mathematicians because there were no more architects in the 6th century after Christ. And the mathematicians were very suspectful about the, and so they made a model. But because Constantinopolis was powerful, they didn't made, make a small model in wood. They made two church, which is still there, called Küçük Hagia Sophia in Turk. In Turk, that means the small Hagia Sophia, with exactly the same structure, just to have an idea how it was going to work. So they have some rough idea of the size of the structure, but, okay, the first one who saw clearly the size effect was Galileo. In his discourse, 1638, he makes this comparison. This is a picture taken from his paper, from his book. He says, if an animal, a small animal, has a bone of this length, it has some cross-section. But if the animal is three times longer, the cross-section is not a three times thicker, but much more. That means that the big animal is more brittle than the small animal. And this is exactly an effect that, as you saw and you are giving me occasion of anticipating now, this is an effect that the Barenblatt or the cohesive energy model can take into account, and we shall see how. Okay, so, we know now what means equilibrium for this type of structure. Okay. Now we must introduce a new concept. It is not new. I mean new for my exposition. That is stability of the solution. We said this morning that all energy minima are equilibrium configuration, but it is not true in general that an equilibrium configuration is an energy minimum. Okay. And in the elementary example which I gave this morning at the very beginning, we had to minimize a function of the type this type. Okay, and what did we do? We wrote this the perturbed equation this way. Plus, here I put a small o of epsilon, but we can go and one term further. And to introduce what is called the second variation. Okay. In this case, if you remember, because everything was reversible, we have to minimize over the real line. At a minimum, the first variation has to be equal to zero. So the first non-null term is a second variation. And of course, we have a minimum or we don't have a minimum depending on the sign of the second variation. If the second variation is positive, and this is true for the convex W, then we have a minimum. If we have a minimum, we have a necessary condition for the minimum. If it is negative, certainly we don't have a minimum. Okay? So we have a second variation a sign of the second variation to inspect. Here it is a bit different because this may be greater than zero. And when it is greater than zero, it makes no sense to consider the second variation. So we have to consider the second variation only when this, for those perturbations for which the first variation is zero. Okay, so let's write this second variation here. Above this line, I'm not forgetting about that. You see that this first variation, I just erased what I needed, is exactly equal to zero just because of this condition, okay? So it disappears from this expression of the difference, and what remains is just the higher order term, which here is hidden inside here. So I can here write that this is equal to 1/2 epsilon square W double prime of U prime, we know now that it is constant, eta prime square plus theta prime, theta double prime of sum U of xj multiplied to the square of the jump amplitude plus a higher order term. Okay? So here we have, before I say that the positiveness of the second variation is just a necessary condition for equilibrium, it is not sufficient. Okay? We are in an infinite dimensional space, and it is not sufficient to have a positive second variation to have a minimum. Then we must develop some strategy to eliminate this term. I mean to write something of second order exact without any remainder. And this is done just by using the Taylor expansion with the Lagrange remainder, expression with an exact remainder. Okay, so instead of writing this, we write, instead of Lagrange remainder means that here, instead of writing U prime, we write U prime plus epsilon sum xi of x, with xi between 0 and 1. Between 0 and eta of x, or if you wish, xi multiplied by eta, it is the same. And here, too, u plus a term xi j, say, which is between 0 and the jump of eta. In this case, we can eliminate this. Okay, so this is an exact expression. So this is already a proof of sufficient condition. I don't wish to go ahead of this. This way we can prove a sufficient condition, which is very close to the necessary condition of stability, which I am going to write now. So I just gave you a hint how to prove a sufficient condition, but I don't wish to do that. So let's go back to the necessary condition in which these terms are not here. Okay. In these terms, we can again use the fact that W U prime is constant, and Here it was multiplied by the integral. Oh. Okay, so we have to do something more complicated. So I don't remember, I have to read here. This is something trivial, but I did some complicated proof for that.
So from the convexity of W prime, so let's forget also about the integral for the moment. We know this. Here I put just the average of U prime this time. Plus W prime of the U prime. Multiplied by the difference of the two. This is badly written because x here and here are the same. So let me just eliminate this x here. Okay, this way. So I take one of the u primes. This is a function of u. And I use the convexity property taken here, just the average of the u across the bar. But if now I over this was u prime of x. If I integrate over 0 L, this is greater or equal that this is a constant, so this is L time W 1 over L multiplied by this integral. Plus the integral of this. The integral is just integral of u prime plus minus L times 1 over L. And what I got is what is called the Jensen inequality. Okay? That holds for every convex function. So it says I integrated over 0 L. Okay, so you make an integral. This is a constant. W of u prime, evaluated at the point. Yes. Moment, you're... No, no. The
error is that here it is the W prime at 1 over L integral of U prime. Yes, this was the error. Okay, thank you. So you take this integral, okay, it is 0, and you get this inequality. So here, forgetting about this development, I just can use that inequality. There is another inequality that I wish to use. So let's keep this. And let's now consider the term theta. We have an expert here on subadditivity, which is Andrea Vaides. So if I make a mistake, I will be corrected immediately. So as I was saying before, till this moment, we made no assumption on the shape of theta. Now we assume that it is concave. So this is true for Griffith, this is true for Barenblatt, this is true for Dardenne. For all cases which we have examined now. So if theta is concave, this means that the convexity inequality holds with the inequality reversed. So theta of jump of u plus, I just write similar to this. Oh, let me. So I called, maybe not appropriate, but I consider a function theta concave, and I call x epsilon two points of its set of definition. Okay. So I write simply that theta of the convex combination of x and y, which is theta of lambda x plus 1 minus lambda y, is less or equal, because now it is less or equal, then, because it is the other way. This is a theta of the convex combination is greater or equal than lambda theta of x plus 1 minus lambda theta of y, and this is for every lambda in 0, 1. Okay? So this means simply that equal to this. Okay, so at this point we can take x equal our jump u and y equal to 0. We can take, I wish to follow exactly what is written here. I can take x equal a plus b and y equal to 0 with a and b positive numbers. So if I apply here, I get that theta of lambda a plus b and then we take also lambda equal to a divided a plus b, which is between 0 and 1. So here I have lambda multiplied a plus b. This means a greater or equal that lambda, which is A over A plus B, multiplied theta of X is A plus D, plus 1 minus lambda theta of Y. And because Y of 0, I am supposing that theta of 0 is equal to 0, so I don't have anything else. Okay, so I have this inequality here, which holds for any pair of numbers, A and B, positive numbers. Okay, now I can write the same inequality with A and B, interchange it. So theta of B greater or equal than B plus A over A plus B multiplied the same thing. And if I sum the two, I have theta of A plus theta of B greater or equal, here I have 1, multiplied theta of A plus B. That means in a concave function with theta of 0 equal to 0, which is our case, this function is subadditive. That means subadditive means that the energy of the sum of two jumps is less or equal than the sum of the energy of the jumps. Okay? We have this property here. So we have to use for our stability analysis these two properties, the Jensen inequality for W and the subadditivity inequality for theta. And this gives the following result. There are three main results which we can prove in this way. The first one is that so let me try to get some space here. The first property which I wish to prove is that an unfactored configuration, so we have a configuration here unfactored, that is without the jumps, and with W of U prime. This inequality is straight. So, if I have an unfactored configuration with this inequality straight, this configuration is metastable. I see that the time is almost over, so I will prove this and I will stop. To prove this, let us write the just the difference. Energy of U plus eta minus energy of U. By the convexity, this is greater or equal. I just skip the intermediate step. W of U prime plus eta prime is greater or equal than L like this. So what I find here is greater or equal than L
And this is equal. U prime, I am in equilibrium configuration, is a constant, so I just write U prime here, plus the integral, 1 over L, the integral of eta prime. But this W here, L, sorry, W, but again, using the boundary condition, this is equal to U prime minus 1 over L the sum of the jumps. And the sum of the jumps, I write them with this notation. That is the discontinuity with the sigma means the sum of all jumps. Okay? And they are, these eta are all positive because U has no jumps. Okay? So this is really the sum of all jumps of the perturbation. And using again the convexity, I have that. So this is W. And this is greater or equal L W prime. Now I have the subadditivity of theta okay, so here I wrote just a piece of the difference. I forgot the other piece, which is theta. Here is, there is something which I wrote right here. This is the sum of theta, theta of x minus minus nothing because I have u, which is not which has no jumps. So I have just this term. But this term sums sum of theta. Is greater or equal than theta of the sum. Which I denoted this way. So here I have to add to this term plus theta of this. And you see that okay, so let me make a picture here. This is my theta as a function of the jump amplitude. And this theta is zero here and is concave. Concave. Okay. So this is the tangent of the origin. So this angle is theta prime of 0. So if this is, for instance, this is eta, and this is the sum of the etas, we see that theta of the sum of the etas is less than w prime of u prime, because w prime of u prime is sigma, and sigma is equal to theta of the jumps, okay? So let me write here, greater or equal, we can forget of this term, which is positive, and we have theta of the eta of sigma minus I made some confusion. Now we are here, okay? This is sigma, which is multiplied by theta. And sigma is equal to theta prime of 0. And this is negative, it is not positive. It is concave. Because it is not zero, because zero is okay. So let me do that. So for the moment, we arrived here safely. Now, let me write that theta of this sum of the jumps is equal to theta prime of 0 multiplied this jump amplitude plus a small o of this eta sigma. Okay? This is just expansion.
Yeah, because you want to put that this is larger.
Yes. So I am just writing that. And that means that this is equal to L. This is something positive, so I have theta prime of 0 minus w prime of u prime, which is sigma, multiplied by eta sigma, plus a smaller sigma. But I am assuming that this is strictly negative, okay? So, I wrote this somewhere here. So that means that if I consider a certain theta here, this is theta zero, theta prime of 0 multiplied by eta sigma, and this is larger than sigma multiplied by this. So sigma is some angle here, which is smaller than the other. Okay? And here I have a small o. Okay? But this is a finite quantity, and this is a small o. So starting from a certain amplitude on, the whole of this will be greater or equal than zero. So for this eta of sigma greater, smaller than a certain limit, this is something greater or equal than zero. So this is a positive number, which is multiplied by this. This is a small o. So I have to prove that this is positive beyond some. So if I just divide by this positive number, I have this, which is finite, plus something which goes to zero. So starting from a certain amplitude on, this term is positive. So I have proved that if eta of sigma is less than some delta, some of the jumps is less than some delta, this difference is positive. But what means this? If you remember, this jump amplitude is smaller than the total variation of eta. So this means that if the total variation of eta is less than that delta, this difference is positive. Okay? So I have proved that it is a local minimum. So it is metastable. Okay, so the result we have proved till now is that except at the point of the formation of fractures, so when theta prime of zero is equal to W prime, for all smaller U primes, we have unfactorized configurations which are metastable. And tomorrow I will prove a second fact that I said this morning I use metastable in the sense that they are local minima. Local minima with respect. Okay. No, but a stable configuration is metastable, okay, in this sense. And tomorrow we shall see what happens about configurations with jumps. And I hope to be able to prepare the lecture tomorrow morning so to be more quick than this evening.
But I object that metastable is stable. The terminology, when you say metastable, you are not only saying that it's a local meaning, but it's really local. I mean, it's not global.
This is just a question of terminology. For me, a local minimum function, can
yes.
be can be global.
For a function, yes, but not for a state.
Okay.
So you see, there are differences.
Yeah, but this is just a second. Okay, so that's.
Scusa.
Ah, sì, sì, grazie.
Was that I was defining the energy of configurations with density rho by doing this inf and lim. So this is the definition that I want to take. This definition is well posed by definition itself. But the problem is whether E of rho exists. I mean, it could be minus infinity. So you see, I take the inf of H of Q over lambda. Lambda is proportional to n, so I need to prove that H of Q, that is the energy of a configuration with n particles, is bounded from below proportionally to n. Okay, so this is called stability. And now if we go back to the definition of the energy, you see that the energy is, except for the one half, is the sum of the interaction of all pairs of particles. Now, the number of pairs, it's proportional to n squared. It's n minus 1 over 2. No? And the potential is not only, is also negative. So it could be in principle that, so in order for this to grow, to be larger than some constant times n, must mean that there are a lot of cancellations. Because there are n squared terms, they, some of them may be negative. If they were all negative, I would be destroyed because it would be minus n squared. Well, I'm saying it goes like minus n times a constant. So there are cancellations. And the first problem that I wanted to discuss in this complement section was to see how this stability comes. Now this is a little bit away from the other lectures, so I will just sketch a little bit of the proof and then move to other things. Yes. Yeah. No. That definitely I want. Since I'm writing something of this sort. So particles which are infinitely far apart must have zero interaction, and the easy thing, the real problems arise if. This goes to zero, V of R goes to zero, but not fast enough. So for instance, for Coulomb interaction, then all this theory would not work. I would have to consider both positive and negative charges, and neutrality conditions gets in, and it's a mess. It's very complicated. This one is much simpler. But it's important that there is a divergence at the origin, otherwise things may not work. So let me, now it's, in Italian I would say it's a gioco di prestigio. So lecture, this one. Okay, so since Mario asked me, I put a full screen. Okay. So and it's still working. So this is the interaction that we are considering. And it's, the interaction is made of two parts. One, so I'm supposing that V has a positive and a negative part. The positive part is finite range, and the negative part is long range, in principle. And I want that the positive part as a non-integrable divergence. It's more than that. It's minus D minus A. And the negative part, well, here I was, I mean, to make it more general, I was saying, I was not willing to suppose that V minus it's smooth, but suppose it is smooth, so forget about the V star. And I want it's a non-increasing integrable function. Okay, so my energy is that one. And the theorem says, I want to sketch is that this energy is stable, which means, as I was saying, that for any configuration Q, the energy of Q is larger or equal than a given constant, minus B, times the number of particles which are in Q. The absolute value of Q means the number of particles. And what I was saying was that since H of Q has a lot of terms, there must be cancellations. So whenever you hear in a theory the word cancellation, you get scared, because cancellations means that you have to enter into the structure of the system, and you cannot do a priori bounds for each term. So let me do this, because I will be using this a lot. I mean, in all the future lecture, I will be doing a coarse graining. So coarse graining is done in this way. I consider a sequence that I call pi superscript L of partition of the space into cubes. And the partitions are made with cubes of side L. And L, I take it of the form 2 to the k, in such a way that one of them refines the other. So you see that the big partition, the big square, which is there, is refined by 4 square of the partition with a smaller side, and so on. So the definition of stability is this one. So V, the energy is stable if there is B such that. The theorem says that V is stable. So the V that I have defined, which is this one, is stable. So I want to prove that if the positive part of B is made in the way I say, then the negative part is integrable and decreasing, then the energy of any configuration is at most minus B times M below. Could be very positive, but cannot be very negative. So in order to do that, just sketching, I'm going fast, I mean, just to give you an idea. So an important point is to introduce this partition. And then I want to say, so the theorem would be, stability would be easy to prove if the particles were not point particles but are spheres. That is, particles must keep a finite distance from each other. Then the configuration Q are countable, and everything works fine. So the assumptions that I'm making, the configuration Q can be unrestricted, you know? So there could be particles as close as we like. So the density could be unbounded a priori. Now I'm saying I want to give a definition which says that that a configuration Q has a density S on some scale, in this case on scale 1. This means that in each cube of my partition of side 1 there are most S particles. That's the meaning of this. And the final theorem that one proves is that if I wanted to minimize the energy, then this will be true. That is, in each cube of side 1, there will be at most some fixed number of particles, not more than that. If I put more than that, then this is not a minimizer. So there is a first lemma which says that if Q has density which is smaller than S, then I can bound the negative part of the interaction by a constant time S. And this comes because B minus was summable. And since the particles cannot, I mean, there are almost S in each cube, this... Okay, so first thing is to prove this lemma. And this I proved it. I mean, I just want to show you that, I mean, with the previous frame, that I proved it, but I don't want you to look at it. I mean, this is an exercise that if you want, you can do it, it's very easy. So let's suppose that this is true, then let's go to the proof that V is stable. So then I go back to the definition, and the definition is saying that H of Q is a sum of terms, and each term is the energy of a particle with all the others, times one half. So H, you see, of R and Q is the interaction of at a point R due to the configuration Q. So it's the sum of the potential between R and QI. And my energy is the sum of this. So if I could prove that this energy at a point R coming from a configuration Q is bounded from below, it will be finished. Because this is minus B, I have in the first sum, I'm summing over the number of particles which are in Q, and then it would be finished. So it would be finished if I had this, but this is not true, unfortunately. Because many particles of Q could be in the position, in the place where the potential Vr is close to the minimum. And so this is negative, and it's proportional to the number of particles which are in Q. No? So if I, if given a point R and want to see what's the interaction due to the configuration Q, if I put all the particles of Q at the minimum of R, I'm getting something which is proportional to that number of particles times the minimum, and I would be lost. But if I do this, all these particles that I've put in the, these are, I call them dangerous, they are close to each other. And if they are close to each other, they are interacting with a positive interaction. No, so there is a, there is some cancellations here. I have to prove that the positive part wins against the negative one, so that in the end it's not convenient to put all the, to put many particles around the minimum. But this looks shaky as an argument, because I have to enter really into the details of the interaction. The point I want to make is that instead it's simple, because it only requires to write the energy in a smarter way. This was something, I guess, was pointed out first by Ruel in his book on rigorous statistical mechanics of 68. It's a classical textbook, and it's very well written. I mean, I guess it's one of the best written books by Ruel. So it's conditioned to the fact that Ruel wrote them. It's very clear and nice.
Excuse me, but when you say that the positive part is negative, this should depend on how important it is. And because it has an energy-Jones potential.
So, I mean, the critical point is that in the argument I'm going to do is that the positive part of the energy diverges at the origin. And that's really the thing which makes the thing work.
Yeah, I was imagining if you have a curve of this kind, and the energy of the positive part is dominating, there's a bigger positive part and a small negative part, so things
would work as well. So the argument I'm giving works for the Lennard-Jones type of thing which diverges. The stability works also for smooth interaction. The important point is that the potential at the origin is sufficiently large with respect to the negative part. So there is, but in this way it's easier. That's why I'm doing that. So the point is to rewrite the energy, not as I've done before, but in this way. So I write the energy of Q as the energy of one of the points of the particles which are in Q. I call it QI, interacting with all the other particles. And then I'm left with the energy. So the second term doesn't contain QI. So it's, you are wiser. I can choose any QI and do this. Okay, so this is, so imagine that this first line is written as in the blackboard. And then the point is to choose QI cleverly. So I choose QI as that particle which has minimal distance with the neighbors. Okay. So if I take the distance between two particles, any two particles in the configuration, this is larger or equal than the distance of particles QI with the closest one to QI. There is always one particle which does this. Okay, so in this way, I know that the density of Q on the scale 1 is bounded in terms of this minimal distance. Because now I know that all particles have distance larger or equal than r. So any two particles are a distance larger or equal than r. So the particles, how many particles can I put in a cube of side 1 is proportional to r to the minus d. Because they have all distance r at least from each other. Okay, so I'm controlling, with this choice of QI, I'm controlling the distance between the density of the configuration Q minus QI. So this will be, so this energy will be the energy, the positive part of the energy. Since QI has a particle at distance R, there is at least this term. And then I took only the negative part. But the negative part has a density which is bounded by definition. It's bounded by C0 R to the D. And then I apply the lemma that I didn't prove, which says that the energy of a particle in a configuration with given density is bounded by C times that. This one. So this is.
You have the sum over all interaction QI with the rest of the world.
Yeah. So I take there is one of these particles which is at distance r,
right.
And this is V plus one.
Yes.
Okay. Then I have the interaction. Of my particle QI with all the others. I only take the negative part of the interaction because I'm bounding from below. The positive part, I throw it away. Okay, so I have the sum. I'm using this lemma, no? No, I'm using this term, this here, no? So my particle, I put it at zero here.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm summing over all the other particles which are in the configuration.
So you sum the negative part over all the cubes, and for the positive part...
I take only that one. So I'm getting this CS and I know this S. No? So using this lemma... So you are referring to this slide? I wanted to concentrate myself on that term. It's useless.
Just wondering whether there was some...
No. So this is C times the density. And the density is C0 to the minus D. Okay, so I... now this is a function of R. And I can take the if. Okay, so the point is that P plus of R is going like R to the minus D minus A, if you remember. No, so it's diverges as R goes to zero faster than the negative part. So it's infinitely positive at the origin. So the limit as R goes to zero is plus infinity. And for this reason, there is a minimum. I need to prove that this infimum is positive. So if it was R to the minus D, I would have to compare that constant with CCC. And it would work. Okay, so now it's finished. No, because I've proved that the first term is larger or equal to minus B. And I'm left with the energy of another configuration, but this is independent of the configuration. Okay, so now, as Mario was saying, I mean, this works as well if V of R was, V plus was not so large as I supposed. If it is large as it is, then I can gain something more. So the idea, it's again by Ruel, was to define a superstable potential. So a potential is superstable if it's the sum of a stable potential plus something which is positive. And the positive means in all this argument, it's important at the origin. So the V1 should be stable, and V2 should be positive, bounded away from zero, positive, in a neighborhood of the origin. So if a potential V is the sum of this, so it's called superstable. And so what happens is not only, as I was saying before, that h of q is larger or equal than minus a constant times the number of particles in q, but it's much larger than that. Because if the local number of particles, ni is the number of particles which are in the cube ci of this partition into... It means that the inf it's positive, strictly positive. And the thing is that if you work out more carefully the proof, you get this result. That is, if you try to put a large number of particles in a cube, CI, the energy grows like the number of particles that you put to 2 plus something. The 2 comes from the fact that if you put n particles, there are n square pairs. And the extra thing, which is A plus over D, comes from the fact that there is an interaction. Now, again, I mean, this is not totally obvious because, I mean, this is clearly the outcome of the positive interaction between particles at the origin. But you have to be careful because there is also the interaction with the other particles. So if you put a lot of particles in some place, there is a local energy which grows, but then there is the interaction of these particles with the other one, which could lead to a negative term. Leads to a negative term. So it's not totally obvious that I'm still gaining. And the heart of the thing here is that indeed this theorem holds and this superstability estimate works. Should say, I forgot to say, that our potential is superstable. Why is it superstable? Because it was, if you remember, the positive part was divergent at the origin, and we had proved that it was stable. But the coefficient in front of the divergent part was arbitrary, so I can take half of it out and call it V2, which I guess I'm doing in this slide. So I can write my V as V1 plus V2, where V2 is half the positive part, and V1 is what it's left. So V1, the same proof as before, it's stable, and V2 is the positive part that I was saying. So this is super stable. Okay, so if we do this, we can prove this theorem, and I don't want to enter now into the details of the proofs. So it's something which is simple, semi-simple, in an algebraic sense. I mean, I've written, if somebody's interested, can read the notes or can discuss with me, I will be happy, but I don't think it's interesting to discuss it. The point is that with this theorem, one can prove the main result is that ground states have bounded density. So using the superstability estimate, one can prove that if I have to minimize the energy, as I was doing in order to compute E of rho, I may limit myself to configurations Q, which have a bounded density on scale 1. Okay? So now, once I'm in this setup, that is, I can minimize with the constraint that configurations have bounded density, then everything works fine, because the interactions are bounded, and one can do a lot of things. So then, so this will be proved in this way. I have to take a configuration with an arbitrary density. I'm working on configurations which have n particles in a region lambda, but the local density may be arbitrarily large because I could put all the n particles in the same cube or something like that. While I want to consider only configurations where in each cube there is a maximal density fixed a priori. So in order to do this, I have to prove that if I take any configuration with local density, which is maybe large, so this configuration has an energy which is larger than another configuration with the total number of particles the same, but with local density which is bounded. So there is the proof goes into this part. So I'm fixing the total density, and then I divide my configuration, you see Q, into two parts, Q prime and Q double prime. So Q prime is the part of Q in the cubes which are nice, so that the number of particles which are there, it's, So Q double prime is the one with small density, and Q prime is the one in the cubes C, which belongs to Mathcal C, where the density is larger than S bar. So these are the dangerous cubes, and these are the other one. So there is a gain estimate and a reconstruction estimate. So the gain estimate is that the contribution, the gain estimate, is telling me that the energy, the initial energy Q, or Q, it's larger than the energy of the nice part. And it's larger in the sense that there is a positive contribution which is given in this form, which reminds of the superstability estimate, if you recall it. So this part is relatively easy. Now I have my configuration Q. In this configuration Q, there are cubes with a large density. So I can say that the contribution of these cubes with large density is bounded in the form which is written on the right-hand side. Okay, so this is the first part, the gain estimate. Why it's not finished? It's not finished because Q double prime has not the density as Q. So I have to take the particles that I have raised, so those of Q prime, which are contributed to this, and I have to add them to Q double prime. And this is the reconstruction estimate. So here I'm losing because I'm putting particles in the, adding particles to a configuration. There is a positive term, and I mean, it could not be. The thing that I'm left with is to prove that if I have my energy configuration Q, then I may add another particle to this configuration without making the energy increase too much. So I have to look in my configuration Q into cubes where the density is not too large, it's smaller than S. And there I can always find the point R where the energy is smaller than something, the increase of energy is smaller than C of S. Okay? So I'm saying I'm taking a a cube. This refers only to something which happens in a cube. So I'm taking, in a cube, I'm putting at most S times the volume of the cube particles. Outside this cube, I'm not saying anything. And I'm adding a particle, and I want to prove that the energy doesn't increase too much if I'm careful in choosing where I add the particle. So for this, I need the cube C to be not sufficiently large. So why do I need the cube to be sufficiently large? Because I want to add the particle, and I'm not saying anything about what's happening outside the cube. So outside the cube, there could be a lot of other particles, and there is also a positive interaction. So I want to put my extra particle well inside the cube, so that it doesn't interact with the others in the positive part. If it interacts negatively, it's all right, because I'm doing an upper bound. Okay. So I may forget about those which are outside. Then inside I have these, let's say, capital N particles. N is smaller than S times C. And then I have to find a place where to add my particle. But, I mean, the volume of, I mean, the there will be certainly some place where that I can find which is not too close to any particle. And this will depend on the number of particles that I put. So there is this CS, which is independent of where are these uniform on the position of the particle inside the cube. Okay, so this is not totally obvious, but I mean, if you think about it, I mean, at some point it comes out. And I mean, this is a typical argument which is used in statistical mechanics, but usually it's done in the grand canonical ensemble. So where this reconstruction estimate, it's much easier because, I mean, you don't even need it, no? Because you just drop the other particles and it's finished. While here, I want to preserve the total number of particles, so once I've gained, I have to be very careful on where to put my extra particles in order to reconstruct the correct density. So this is the most difficult part, technically difficult part of what I was saying. Once you have all these estimates about the energy and the fact that the energy is bounded, then it's easy to prove that the inf is actually a minimum. That the liminf is actually a lim in the definition that I was saying of E of rho, and then it's also easy to prove that the sequence of regions lambda that I use in doing the thermodynamic limit can be quite arbitrary. Technically, it's Banov sequences, and then one can also prove that. That the final energy that one gets is actually a convex function of rho. So E of rho is a convex function of rho. So this a priori would tell you that the energy ET of rho that I was considering this morning, that is the energy in the triangular lattice, cannot be the correct energy because it's not convex. Okay, so. I don't know, maybe I could organize, Francesco, che dici? Stoppo qui? I think it's, because I may add something about the thing of tomorrow, positive temperature, but maybe it's better to stop it here. So if you want to ask questions or discuss things, you are very welcome. Thank you.